So now let us look at the question number 11. It says an entity relationship model, suppose R, is a many to one relationship from an entity E1 to entity E2. So assuming that this is the entity E1 and this is denoting the entity E2 and this is denoting the relationship R, and it is a many to one relationship from entity E1 to entity E2. Assuming that E1 and E2 participate totally in R, so that means the participation ratio of E1 is 1 and participation of E2 is also 1, and the cardinality of E1 is greater than the cardinality of E2, correct? Now, which of the following is true about this relationship R, or this relation R? Okay, this actually it will call as a relationship. It's called as a relationship. So don't confuse a relationship with a relation. Now, option number A, every entity in E1 is associated with exactly one entity in E2. That is true, correct? Every entity in E1 is associated with exactly one entity in E2. So, from here, option number B is saying some entity in E1 is associated with more than one entity in E2. That is wrong. Option number C is saying every entity in E2 is associated with exactly one entity in E1. That is also wrong. And every entity in E2 is associated with at most one entity in E1. That is also wrong. Okay, so let me give you the reason. See, here from this, what can you infer from this? Number one, no entity in E1 can be related to more than one entity in E2. No entity in E1 can be related to more than one entity in E2. And this is the reason why the option number 2 is wrong. That option number 2 is saying some entity in E1 is associated with more than one entity in E2, which is clearly saying opposite of this. That is why option number 2 is wrong. And second thing that you can infer is an entity in E2, an entity in E2 can be related to more than one entity in E1. An entity in E2 can be related to more than one entity in E1. Why? See, generally when I'm saying cardinality of this E1 here is 1 and cardinality of this E2 here is M. That is why when we write the cardinality ratio, the cardinality ratio representation, that means we write this cardinality here and we write this cardinality here. And what does this cardinality mean? When I'm saying cardinality of E1, now this cardinality of E1 means that in how many relationships this E1 can participate. Okay. So when I'm saying cardinality of E1 is 1, that means one entity of E1 can participate to only one entity of E2. But when I'm saying cardinality of E2 is M, that means one entity of E2 can participate in many entities of E1. Okay. So this is the reason what we can infer from this. Now, in option number C, they are saying every entity in E2 is associated with exactly one entity in E1. Now, when they are saying exactly one, that is also wrong. Why? Because an entity in E2 can participate in more than one entities, so it is wrong. And option number D is saying an entity in E2 is associated with at most one entity in E1. That is also wrong because of this. Okay, so the only correct answer here is option number A. Now, let us check out the question number 12. Consider the following two tables and four queries in SQL. So we have two tables, one is book and second one is stock. So assuming that this is a book table, okay, and here we have ISBN and second is book name, correct, and second one is stock. Here we have ISBN and second one is copies, correct. Now they are saying query 1, select book ISBN, select stock copies, book ISBN and stock copies from book B, inner join stock S on ISBN, book ISBN is equal to stock ISBN. Okay, Second query, select book ISBN stock, comma stock copies from book B, left outer join. Here we have inner join and on ISBN. Okay, like this. In option number 3, the entire query is same. The only thing that is differing is the right outer join. In option number 4, the entire query is same. The only thing that is differing is full outer join. Now they are asking, which of the queries above is certain to have an output that is superset of the outputs of the other three queries? That is, which of the following queries is actually having the is the superset? Guys, all these queries are same. The only thing is that they are simply asking you whether you know what is the joins, what is the inner join, what is left outer join, what is right outer join, and what is the full outer join. Let me demonstrate these joins with an example. Assuming that this is the relationship A, this is a relation A, not relationship, it is relation, and this is the relation B. Between relation A and relation B, if I take the inner join, if I take inner join means we are going to get this data which is common in both of them. Okay, when I'm taking the left inner join, this is A and this is B, and if I take left inner join, that means I'm going to get this data which is totally in A but not in B, which is totally in A and B and in A, but the data which is not in B, this data that will not come. Okay, when I'm saying right outer join, the right outer join will give us this data. If this is A, this is B, and this is showing the right outer join, then it will give us this data. And when I'm saying full outer join means if this is A and this is B, the full outer join will give us all the data which is present in both the tables. Okay, so this is going to give us full outer join. So to solve this question, actually you don't even need to know more about SQL queries. You don't even it's not required that you should know what is the data inside these tables. It is not at all required. The only thing that you should know, what is the inner join, what is left inner join, what is right inner join, and what is full outer join. If you know all this information, then you can obviously solve this question very easily. Okay, now when I'm saying which is the superset of other three, obviously this full outer join is a superset of other three. So answer is option number D here, and it's a very very easy question. As you can see, it hardly take 10 seconds to solve this question if you know the concept behind this one. Okay, so next one is match the following. Number one is UDP header port number. So they're giving us some fields, and they're giving the length of the fields in bits. So one is UDP header length. You should know what is a UDP header port number length. Second is Ethernet MAC address. Third is IPv6 next header, and fourth is TCP header sequence number. Now let us try to see the information that we already know. We know what is a MAC address. Okay, so MAC address is of 48 bits. As you see, generally we give the MAC address in hexadecimal numbers. What is the IPv6 next header length? That is of 8 bits. Okay, and what is the TCP header sequence number? That is of 32 bits. Okay, so if you match this one, that is Ethernet MAC address is of 48, IPv6 next header that is of 8 bit, TCP header sequence number that is of 32 bit, and that is why UDP header port number is of 16 bit. So even if you don't know what is the header length or port numbers or these fields, for all of them, if you know at least three of them, you can find out the fourth one. Okay, so the answer to this question here is option number for P it is 4, for Q it is 1, for R it is 2, and for S it is 3. So it is 4 1 2 3. 4 1 2 3 is not there, this is also not there. 4 1 2 3, this is correct and this is wrong. Okay, so this information you should know. Now let us look at the next question here. It is saying, consider the following statements regarding the slow start phase of TCP congestion control algorithm. Know that CWND stands, here they are in CWND stands for the TCP congestion window. This is showing the congestion window. And MSS denotes the maximum segment size. Maximum segment size and congestion window. Now, what is this TCP congestion windows? This TCP congestion windows, initially, it grows exponentially, TCP congestion window, but when there is one congestion that it will form, then it will go only linearly. Okay. Let us explore the options one by one, then you will understand what I am saying. Here they are saying that congestion window increases by 2 MSS on every successful acknowledgement. Okay, option number 2, the congestion window approximately doubles on every successful acknowledgement. Option number 3, the congestion window increases by 1 MSS, that is 1 maximum segment size every round trip time. Number 4, the congestion window approximately doubles every round trip time. Okay. So, what happens is every time an acknowledgement is received by the sender, the congestion window is increased by 1 segment. So, whenever we get an acknowledgement, then this congestion window is increased by 1 segment, which is also called as 1 MSS. And this congestion window increases exponentially on every RTT, that is every round trip time, it increases exponentially, right? So here you can see that out of all these options, option number 1 is saying congestion window increases by 2 MSS on every successful acknowledgement. Now this congestion window does not increase by 2 MSS, but rather it only increases by 1 MSS. So this 2 MSS is wrong, that is why option number 1 is wrong. Number 2, the congestion window approximately doubles on every successful acknowledgement. Now, when they are saying it doubles on every successful acknowledgement, that is wrong because initially it increases exponentially, but later on it increases only linearly. So, it is not correct. The third one is saying that congestion window increases by 1 MSS on every round trip time. Here, this one, when they are saying 1 MSS on every round trip time, so it can also be said like this, that congestion window size increases with every acknowledgement by 1. So whenever we get an acknowledgement, the congestion window size increases by 1, but at every round trip time the congestion window sizes increases exponentially. So it's not exactly doubled, but it's very close to double. Okay, so in the same way, this option number 3 is saying the congestion window increases by 1 MSS every round trip time, but every round trip time the congestion window size is approximately doubled. It's not exactly, but it is approximately doubled. Okay, and the option number 4 is saying the congestion window approximately doubles every round trip time, which is correct. Option number 3 is wrong. So let me explain it again. The option number 1 saying the congestion window size increases by 2 MSS on every successful acknowledgement, that is wrong. On every successful acknowledgement it only increases by 1 MSS. Option number 2, the congestion window approximately doubles on every successful acknowledgement, wrong. It doubles on every round trip time, approximately doubles. Okay, so this word approximately is very important. Number 3, the congestion window increases by 1 MSS on every round trip time, this is wrong, because it approximately doubles here, it is not 1 MSS. And the fourth one, the congestion window approximately doubles every round trip time, and this is correct. Okay, so you should know that why option number 1, 2 and 3 are wrong. If you see the options here, so option number C is the correct answer for this given question. Let us look at the question number 15. It says, two people P and Q decide to independently roll two identical dices, each with 6 faces numbered from 1 to 6. The person with the lower number wins. Person with the lower number wins. In case of a tie, they roll the dice repeatedly until there is no tie. Okay. Define a trial as a throw of the dice by P and Q, assuming that all 6 numbers on each dice are equiprobable and all the trials are independent, and the probability that round to 3 decimal places that one of them wins on the third trial is. Okay, so we have to tell one of them wins on the third trial. Okay, so for the third trial, they know that they'll try every time until there is no tie. To reach to the third trial, there should be first two trials should be a tie, then only they will reach to the third trial. So we can see one of them, when they are saying one of them wins, one of them wins on the third trial, on the third trial, it implies that the first two trials would be a tie, and third trial, and third trial should not be a tie, then only they will be in the third trial. So probability of a tie, what is the probability of tie? It will be 6/36. Okay, it will be 6/36, which will be equal to 1/6. And what is the probability of no tie? Probability of no tie, that will be equal to 1 minus probability of tie, which will be equal to 5/6. Okay, now if they want to win in third trial, that means the first trial should be a tie, then the second should be a tie, and the third should not be a tie, Okay, so what is the probability of first to be a tie? Probability of first to be a tie is 1/6. Probability of second to be a tie is also 1/6. Now probability of third not be a tie, that will be 5/6. So if I calculate these values, then it will be 5/216, which is equal to, if you calculate this value, it will be 0.0231. Now that is the probability of this third trial to be not to be a trial. So the answer to this question is 0.0231. That is the correct answer to this question number 15. Now let us look at the next video, question number 16 to 20.